But we're going to do a song that you do know. QC, guys. Will the circle be unbroken? How about that? Hand clap along with this.
Are you ready to start it off there, Darryl?
Everybody loves this song. It was a big hit for Marilyn Sellers, and
I don't know.
asked Daryl if he was going to say anything tonight, because usually he's interrupted me every 5 seconds. And he said, I'm not going to say one word. Not one word. Almost.
He's doing pretty good so far.
This song was the one I wanted to start with because, man, I bet you I did this song when I was 12 years old. And it's an old Dolly Parton song. It's called Golden Streets of Glory. How many of you ever heard this song? Here we go, Daryl. Nope, right down here. We got a couple. Oh, no, look, there they are, Daryl.
Okay, we got two people in the room.
No, there's about four or five that raised their hand. This is a...
I think you're lying.
This is not lying. Jay said he's never heard it either.
Daryl spoke.
He spoke. There you go. This is a great, great song. Great, great words. It's kind of unusual. It's got an unusual melody, a little bit of an unusual beat. But it's a great song. Glory to His name. Oh, holy, two albums, and this is on it. Have you been to Jesus? Don't you think he's now? Are you asking to learn and pray? Are you been to Jesus? What he did is good. Is he something I'm embarrassed to learn and pray? All of you, I'm out of breath.
Victory in Jesus.
Victory in Jesus. Oh man, that's such a great song, yeah. You know, as soon as I capture my breath here, this song, how many of you have ever been to a camp meeting? Been to a camp meeting, tent revival. I'm not going to sing this song, I probably should have sang, but I don't want to come back. If you invite me back, if you invite us back. I was in a camp revival, and it was a big old tent, and I was singing "Till the Storm Passes By." I remember that song. And it was nice and calm before I started singing that song, and then all of a sudden the storm came up, and it was just a banging. I mean, the rain was just coming in the sides through the whole time I was singing "Till the Storm Passes By," and As soon as I ended it, it stopped. It was just amazing how that happens, how God works in this to keep me safe till the storm. We were safe in that tent. It was a huge old tent. But we thought the tent was going to collapse. But I just kept singing the song till the storm passes by. And I'll never forget that. I'll never forget that song. I love that song to this day. But we were safe inside of that. And then as soon as the song ended, the storm stopped. Yeah. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. I love God. And I... He has protected me all my life since I was a little girl. And I've got so many stories to tell, but this song is called "Is the Door Standing Open for Me?" For me and for you, my troubles are many, my pleasures are few. But I don't complain because I know I'll be free if I can get to heaven someday. And I think that's what we're all longing for.
I'm not afraid.
many of you remember an old family Bible in your house as you were growing up?
Oh yeah.
Maybe you still got it. Yeah. Yeah. Maybe your mother read to you, or maybe your father read to you. And we hang on to things like that. This was a song, we were talking about this earlier, that Willie Nelson wrote and sold it for $50. And we were talking about that. He still doesn't regret it to this day because he needed the money. He needed the cash. But what a great, great song this is. Everybody treasures this song because of the words. And Daryl's going to sing it for you right now. It's called Family Bible.
Oh,
I told you I was an evangelistic singer. I think I fell in my aunt's footsteps. I didn't even know about it until I was maybe 15, 16 years old. She had a tabernacle in Nashville, and it was down the street from the Ryman, and it was called the Tabernacle. And she had a lot of the old evangelists, like Oral Roberts, J.C. Bishop, all those evangelistics, evangelists used to come and preach in her tabernacle. And eventually it burned down, but my dad would grow up and he would sweep the floors after all the big revivals. They had all-night sings in that place. Remember the all-night sings? Have you heard about that? They were done in this tabernacle. Literally, they would go all night long. And she wrote a song, and my dad went looking for her. He couldn't find her for years, and later found that she was in a nursing home in Tampa, Florida. So we found her, and she had Alzheimer's really bad, and when we got to the nursing home, they said, "She won't recognize you. She hasn't spoke for probably 3 years." And so I took my guitar in, and she had written a song and had it recorded, and a lot of people were saved by this song. We were going down the road one day and playing the radio, and we tuned into a gospel show, and one guy said that he was walking down the street, basically homeless, and he heard her singing this song in an old tent revival, and he went to the tent revival, and he got saved that night from her singing this song. And we heard it on the radio, him telling the story of how he got saved. And so we got to the nursing home, I got the guitar out, and I started singing her song. And she looked up, and she started singing the song. She goes, "That's my song." And so, you know, a lady that hadn't spoken 3 years, but she recognized her song, and she knew every word, sang every word with me. And so music plays such a huge part in life. And that's what we do at Morgan's Music Junction. It's a movement. That's what we want to do. We want to touch people's lives. And through this COVID thing, there's been a few people coming out. But we try to do things to help people, just like you're doing here. Because without God, I just don't know what people do in times like these. Don't be afraid. If you got God in your heart, if you really got God in your heart, there's nothing to be afraid of. Amen. That's what I believe.
Amen.
God is going to be with us. When it comes our time to die, we're going to die. That's what I believe. It's a personal decision. I don't fault anybody for what they believe, but everybody has a right to believe what they believe. We have a flag that tells us that we have freedoms. But where did the freedom come from to begin with? It came from God. Don't you believe that?
Amen.
It came from God. He's the one that started it all. So I would like to do this song. It's called, "What Would I Do Without Jesus?" What would I do without Jesus? He leads the way from day to day. Life would be empty without Him. Life's a story. name was Jordan Swain. And what a beautiful song. She did a great work in her day. Passed away in the nursing home not too long before we had visited her. Died in peace. Great, great. All these beautiful songs. Okay, let's see, where am I? Cup things up a little bit here. You all know this one's time to get up and sing clap and sing and sing along.
Let me have that spirit.
that was one of her favorite songs of all times, was Rock of Ages and Beyond the Sunset. She loved those two songs. This song is a Jimmy Fortune song. We fell in love with Jimmy Fortune. We had him at the Opry several times, and what a great, great man. Of course, my favorite song that he does of all times, of course, is that one, I Believe. But this one is on his album, and I like to do this song. It's got that, it's got a country feel to it, but it's got beautiful words to it. It's called Over the Sunset Mountains, key of A.
Yeah.
all. All right, that was pretty awesome. Thank you guys.
Thank you.
You guys are great. That was really awesome. I'm good. I was happy to hear Daryl talk and sing. All right.
And play
the guitar. That's right. How's everybody doing tonight?
Blessed.
Alright, me too. I'm blessed. Has everybody been washed in the blood?
Amen.
Alright, very good. Me too. It's been a good week so far. Everybody have a good week. Everybody come out tonight, get a little bit of that midweek pump of Jesus.
Amen.
Right, get a little extra pump. Get through the week. I've been back at my office now a little bit, and officially this week. Basically every other week I'm working 3 days, every other week I'm working 2 days, so I'm half time back at the office and the other half of the time still working out of the house, you know. We're trying to get back to normal and getting ready for Medicare, you know, open enrollment for Medicare is coming, you know, it's what I do for one of the things I do for a living. So we're getting all ready for that and getting prepared. And let me get that microphone up to my mouth, huh? I'm always trying to remind ourselves about that. I'll tell you what, God is good. What do you think? God is good?
Amen.
All the time. All right, well, most of you know me. My name is Pfeiffer. I'm with the Christian Motorcyclists Association and member of this church. And I just love every opportunity I get to get up and share with you guys and just share what God's putting on my heart. And before we get started, let's go ahead and bow our heads and let's pray. Father God, we just come to you, Lord, and I just want to thank you, Lord. We want to thank you, Lord, for being such an awesome God, for allowing us to be washed in your blood, for allowing us to go down to the river and watch you walk on water, for all the wonderful things that you allow us, sinners, to do, because you loved us enough to let your Son die for us on the cross. Lord, be with us tonight. Be with me tonight. Let your word speak out of my mouth, Lord. And let hearts be opened and touched tonight, Lord, as you speak through me. And that you use your word, your kindness, your love, that somebody in this room's life might be changed tonight. In Jesus' name. Or even on Facebook, maybe their lives will be changed as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, you know, I don't know about y'all, but I'm sure ready for things to get back to normal. And I've been joking a little bit, telling people, I said, well, I think things are going to get back to normal on November 4th, day after the election.
right.
Maybe. We'll see. I don't know, man. But there's a lot of craziness going on. But the thing is that I know that no matter what's going on, God is still in control.
Amen.
God is in control. And politics aren't going to control anything. And I got faith that whatever we're going through right now, there's a reason. God's allowing us to go through what we're going through, and there's a purpose behind it. Maybe he's trying to teach us a lesson about the way our nation has been going. Maybe he's trying to shake the tree a little bit and make some things happen. I don't know what it is, but I got faith that God's got a purpose and a plan. So speaking of faith, I want to talk to you a little bit about that tonight. Now, I know with everything going on right now between the virus and the protesting, and it's easy to get caught up in all those lies and deception that's going on. But we got something firm to hold on to.
Come on.
And his name is Jesus.
Amen. Woo!
And he's a firm foundation. I don't know how some of these folks are making it without him. Because I know what little bit of TV I am watching, which we don't watch much. I can't even watch sports right now. We usually like to watch sports. I don't even want to watch them right now because, you know, everybody's just acting all kind of crazy. So, you know, we just try to keep ourselves busy with other things and get more in the Word or do whatever, you know, stay busy getting things done around the house or whatnot. But I don't know how those folks are going without having Jesus in their life, and I know a lot of them don't. You can just tell. You can just see by what's going on in their life. But I do want to talk a little bit about faith. Now, what does faith mean? It's one of those words that's not always used the way it's meant to be used. A lot of times people think faith is, well, one of the definitions here in dictionary.com, it gives 8 different explanations of the word faith. Okay? Now what's interesting is 3 out of those 8 definitions refer to God or religion. And they're part of the 8. So that's kind of interesting. One of them is belief that is not based on truth. Or on proof, rather. Belief that's not based on proof. Now, do you think that is the definition of the word faith that's used in the Bible? No, I don't think so. I don't think it is. Because I think that the Bible proves God is real all over the place. The closest direct definition in the Bible, I find it in Hebrews 11:1, and it says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen."
Come on.
Amen?
Amen.
From this particular passage, we see that the central feature of faith is confidence or trust. In the Bible, the object of faith is God and His promises. God promises things, and it's up to us to have faith to believe His promise. A clear example of this is Abraham's encounter with God in Genesis 15. Now, I'm not going to read the whole chapter. Most of you know the story. This is the story of when God called Abraham out and shared what his life was going to be, told him about how he was going to be the founder of Israel. And Abraham trusted and believed God. And let's see here. In response to God's promise of countless descendants, it says that in 15:6, it says that Abraham believed the Lord and he counted it to him as righteousness. So do you understand that? Abraham believed the Lord, and the Lord counted that belief to Abraham as righteousness.
Amen.
That means that when we believe in the Lord, when we put our faith in the Lord, when we trust in the Lord puts that to us as righteousness. That means that He is making us righteous because of our belief in Him. Did you know that you were righteous if you believe in God? Not if you don't believe in God. Now, come on. Let's get real here. There's a lot of people out there that think they're righteous because they believe in God, but not because they believe God. There's a big difference. There's a big difference. We can believe God up here, but we can believe in God up here, but we believe God down here in our hearts. That 12-inch space between our head in our heart. The Apostle Paul writes in Romans 4:20-21, he said, "He did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform." Faith means putting your trust in God and having confidence that He will fulfill the promise. Do you believe that God's going to fulfill any promise He's given to you? Every single one of them, huh? Let me tell you a little story. What's the lady that was singing? Where's she at? Suzanne. Okay. Suzanne, you shared a little story about that storm in that tent. Let me tell you, this is something that God has done with me for years. Ask my wife, ask some people that have ridden with me, and they'll tell you. Yesterday, I'm on my way home from work, and I decided yesterday morning, it was nice out, and I was going to ride my motorcycle. Now, you know, we got storms rolling through like left and right now. But I got a little faith. I trust that the Lord is, even if he lets me get wet, he's going to let me get wet at the right time. But you know what? Yesterday, he didn't even let that happen. Because I'm coming back home to my house. I'm riding up 301. And, of course, yesterday was voting day. And we needed to vote. And I had told Elaine she didn't get a chance to vote in the morning. I was running a little bit late, so I didn't stop and vote in the morning. So I called her from work and said, why don't you just, you know, we'll meet back at the house and we'll run down there because it's a church down the street from our house and we can vote. So I'm running by. Well, the last time I went to that church and voted, as I'm standing there voting, the bottom let out. And I mean, it just rained. And I'm only like a mile, maybe 2 miles from that church. But by the time I got home that day, I was completely drenched. My boots were, I could pull my boots off and turn them upside down and water come out. Because I was on my motorcycle that day too. I don't know why God let me get wet. Maybe because he knew I was just going to go home. But yesterday he knew I had to go home and leave again. So I'm riding home and I'm going by that church and I'm looking ahead. And it is pouring up the road. And I'm like, man, is it going to happen again? Maybe I need to pull in right now and go ahead and vote. Let her just go down there and do it in the car later. I'm going. I go right by the church. And I get closer to my house, and right in my house, there's a big curve in the road. So you can't really see what the road looks like right at my house because it's, you see a tree line because of the curve, you know? I don't know. It's like, I'm going to get soaked. The roads are soaking wet, but no rain. I pull up to the street, make my turn, pull into my yard, put my kickstand down, run over, open up my shop. I pull the motorcycle inside the shop. And as soon as I put my foot on the ground, the bottom just let out. And I mean, it poured, flooded my whole yard out. I was like, thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
I mean, you know, he was so faithful right there. And you know, you could say, oh, you just got lucky or whatever. Listen, I've had that happen to me so many times. Even if God didn't make that happen, I'm going to give him the glory anyway, because he deserves it. You know, but I do believe he did it. I believe he protected me for that reason. Man, it is so awesome, those little stories, because those are the things that build our faith. They make us stronger. And God has promised to protect us no matter what is going on. He's promised to protect us and watch over us. Faith is more than just an intellectual agreement. It is believing and putting it into action. You may believe... You may have faith, but what if you're talking about getting into an airplane and flying away, okay? You got faith that that plane's going to work. You got faith that that pilot knows how to fly it, right? But is that faith really going into action until you actually get on the plane and fly away, right? You're not putting that faith into action. Now, some people maybe just don't have that faith. Okay, I get it. I don't much like airplanes either. I'd rather ride my motorcycle 2,000 miles. But it's just, you know, it's an example. Like, we might have faith in something, but until we put that faith into action, we're not exercising it.
Come on.
We're not using it. We're not trusting that it's real until we put it to work. We can sit around and talk about it all day long, but until we do something with it.
Faith without works is dead.
Well, hey, that's what I'm getting ready to share right here in James 2:14-17. That's all right, brother. At least I know you know what we're talking about, right? And it says right there, it says, what does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit? Thus also, faith by itself, if it does not have works, it is dead. Put another way, the obedience that pleases God comes from faith rather than a mere sense of duty or obligation. So if I go out and buy my wife flowers, which I don't do often enough. I do go out and buy her flowers. And a lot of times, it might not even, like, it's not around an anniversary, or I just might just go do it. But if I just go do it because I feel like I'm obligated to go do it, is that really doing any good?
No.
No. It means a whole lot more because I do it because I really want to, because I know that it's going to make her smile. I know it's going to make her feel good. It's going to remind her how much I care about her. And trust me, she needs a lot of flowers, because it takes a lot to care about somebody like me. Okay? It takes a little extra. I used to tell people when we got married, I said, congratulations to me and condolences to her. Because, you know, but she'll tell you the same thing. I don't agree. I think I'm rougher than she is on me. We're rough on each other. We have a good time because we needed each other. We're any kind of compliment. God had to give me somebody that can step up to me when I need to be stepped up to. Faith is so important because it is the means by which we have a relationship with God. Ephesians 2:8, Paul writes, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it is the gift of God." We didn't do anything. It's all about Him. We couldn't do it even if we wanted to. Now, I believe we got maybe one little tiny responsibility, and that's in making a decision that God is real. But everything apart from that comes from God. He gives us the strength to do it. He gives us the strength to follow that decision through. And He's the one that gives us the strength to walk the walk that we're supposed to walk. But if we're not seeking Him, we're still not going to have that walk. And we can't seek Him without that faith. Faith is how we receive the benefits of what Jesus has done for us. Jesus lived a life of perfect obedience to God. He died to pay the penalty for our sinful rebellion against God. And He rose from the dead to defeat sin, death, and the devil. By putting our faith in Him, we receive forgiveness for our sins and the gift of eternal life. Now let me ask you, does everybody in this room believe that?
Amen.
That is the gospel right there.
Amen.
Do you believe that you are a sinner and Jesus died for you?
Amen.
I want you to think about that right now, because if there's anybody in this room that isn't sure about that, we're going to talk about it again here in a little while. So how can we exercise our faith right now in this crazy world? What can we do? What can we do right now with the craziness that's going on? Everybody's focused on the politics. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about that, but I'm not going to get into politics the way you might think. But I'm going to share a little bit about what's going on there. We live in a great nation, and I believe that this country is one of only two countries, and I shared this last week, but this is one of only two countries in the history of our planet that were formed by God. It's us, and it's Israel. They're the only two. But let me tell you something. The enemy is trying to take it away, just like he took it away from Israel, because let me tell you, that's what the enemy did. He succeeded with Israel in a sense. Now, they're still God's chosen people. And no matter what you do, that's never going to go away. But the enemy had his hand in the destruction of Israel. You know, last year I shared with some of you the story that we were talking, the Bible study I was involved in, and how, you know, we went through all these times over and over again where God kept coming back, sending this person and that person, that prophet and this prophet. And they would come and they'd bring Israel back, and they'd get their act together, and then they'd turn right around and go back to their evil ways. We're doing the same thing here, folks. Our country is slowly but surely turning away from God. Evil is trying to take over. And I think almost everybody in here probably agrees with that. Religion and Christianity has been severely suppressed here over the last three or four generations. Does everybody agree with that? Well, let me tell you something. One of the main ingredients of socialism, communism, or any of them other isms, fascism, whatever, is taking away the faith of the people.
Come on.
And getting them to turn away from their belief and trust in God. And that's what's going on in this nation right now. This isn't a physical battle, folks. This isn't even a political battle. This is a spiritual battle between good and evil. And it's up to us as Christians to get out there and use our faith and remind people. Now, I'll tell you, I'm a Trump supporter. If you don't like that, that's okay. We all got our right. That's part of being in America. But you know what? I don't believe God that Trump is going to save our country. I believe that God is going to save our country.
That's right.
Does that mean I'm not going to go out and vote? No, I'm going to go out and vote because that's where works comes into play.
Exactly.
Are you praying about who you're going to vote for? Are you comparing the people you're going to vote for to the things that they believe in and what the Bible says?
Come on.
What are we doing with that? Are we trusting in God enough to know that He will give us the direction and know what to do when we go to those polls? When we write that piece of paper out and mail it in, whatever it is, we've got to be following the Lord. We got to be putting Him first. And if you're in there listening to me on Facebook, let me tell you something. If you're planning on putting Trump in office just because you think he's going to save your country, but you're not living the life that God would have you live, then your vote might not even be any good. Because God is going to be the one that's going to put that person in office, no matter who it is. And He's going to do it according to the hearts of the people of this nation.
Amen.
It's about us. It's about our hearts. It's about what are we doing to share. One of the things I've been doing, when I get on Facebook and I see somebody put a post, I remind them, God's in control. Good or bad, whatever, it doesn't matter. I don't have to say anything bad about the person they're talking about or good about the person they're talking about, but I'm going to remind them that it's not about that person, that it's all about Jesus. And if we don't step up and get going with that, we're going to be in trouble. What good will 4 more years get us if we're right back in the same place 4 years from now?
That's right.
Hey, I just assume let the Lord return out. That's what we're going to do.
Yeah,
just get it over with.
That's what I'm saying.
You know, if we're going to keep going the same direction in our nation and the behaviors and the things we're doing, let's just get it over with. Let them come back. Shared it all. Heck, I got through all my notes. Look at that. It's great that we want to save our nation, but how do we live our lives? What kind of example are we giving to people? Us as Christians. What kind of example are we setting? We have to point people to the Lord. We have to have faith. We have to have trust that God's going to protect us. We can't be scared. Just like Suzanne mentioned, we can't be afraid. Don't get out there and say, well, I don't want to tell people about that because I'm afraid what they're going to do. Let me tell you something. They're not rejecting you. They're rejecting God.
Come on.
They're rejecting God. And if you point them to God, then they're going to go vote for the right person. It's that simple. Point them to the Lord and let Him lead and guide their steps. He'll do it. God has a plan, and God is going to protect you. But you have to put it into work.
Amen.
By stepping out in faith.
Amen.
To see what He will do. Have you had somebody in your life that you wanted to talk to about Jesus? And you're just a little bit scared to do it? I think probably all of us have. Even me. And my wife will tell you, I'll talk to anybody, it don't matter. But you know what? There's people out there, it's like, wow, you know, what's he going to say? What's he going to do? We got to trust the Lord. Pray about it. And ask God to give you the oomph, the strength that you need to open up your mouth and share with that person. Do what you got to do. Do what you know God is going to do. You know, a couple weeks ago I did a funeral, and I shared just a little bit last week, but a couple weeks ago I did a funeral for a guy in the Outlaws Motorcycle Club. And many of you probably remember about a year and a half ago I shared that I led a guy to the Lord. Well, this was the same guy. last year, last November 2018, a year and a half ago, I led this fellow to the Lord. And 3 weeks ago, he was killed on his motorcycle. Somebody pulled out in front of him, just ran him over. We see it all the time. But you know what? What if I hadn't been obedient and done what God called me to do and led him to the Lord that day and prayed with him? Now, his name is in the book of life. So if he was supposed to get there, he was going to get there. Whether I was obedient or not, God was going to use somebody. But the fact of the matter is, I was obedient, and I did what I was supposed to do that day. And it wasn't an easy thing for me to do. But I had to open up my mouth and share. And God had me do it. But the thing is, 2 weeks ago at this funeral, my wife will tell you, there's this fella, and what I say here about this stuff, please, it absolutely has to stay in this room. Okay? But there's this fella in that club, and his name is Hillbilly. And I want you all to pray for Hillbilly. He used to be the Nashville, he may or still be, I don't know, but he's real high up, real high level in the club. I mean, he might have been the world boss even, I don't know. But he is like, she'll tell you, he's like the only guy that even intimidates her. And he's intimidating. He's this big, bald-headed guy with tattoos everywhere. And it don't bother me. These guys don't bother me. But this guy right here, man. And when I went up there to do that funeral, he's standing there. And another guy that I've known that's in the club for years, they got him because he found out that I was doing a funeral. He's known me for a long time. So he comes over and says, hey, man. He goes, now I know what you're going to get up there and do and what you're going to say, but you need to keep it short. You don't need to get into all that crazy preaching stuff. And I said, man, I said, you guys know what I do. You asked me to do this, didn't you? You know I got to say what I got to say. I know. I said, just keep it short. Well, that other guy's standing right there, and he's listening, and he's looking down at me. And I mean, this guy's a pig. He's a big guy. But fact of the matter is, I believe that man someday is going to come around. I believe that God is going to touch his life one day. I believe God is going to do something right with him. So pray for him. Before we go, I want to revisit that little thing I shared earlier. It says here that Jesus lived a life of perfect obedience to God. He died to pay the penalty for our sinful rebellion against God, and he rose from the dead to defeat sin, to defeat death, and to defeat the devil. By putting our faith in him, we receive forgiveness for our sins and the gift of eternal life. Now again, I ask, is there anyone in this room that doesn't have those words planted deeply and firmly in your heart? Because if you don't, I'm going to ask you to come up here right now. If there's anybody out there on Facebook watching and you don't have them words planted in your heart, then I'm just going to ask you to pray with me right now. And we're going to get that settled. Everybody please bow their heads. Father God, we just come to you, Lord. We thank you for this day. Lord, we come to you recognizing what you did for us. And I'm just going to ask everybody to repeat this prayer as we go through these steps of salvation. Say, Father God.
Father God.
I come to you right now.
I come to you right now.
Acknowledging that I'm a sinner.
Acknowledging that I am a sinner.
Knowing that you sent your son.
Knowing that you sent your son.
Jesus. To die for me on the cross.
To die for me on the cross.
That my sins were placed on his shoulders.
That my sins were placed on his shoulders.
So I could have salvation.
So I could have salvation.
So that I could be cleansed.
So that I could be cleansed.
And so I could live with you forever.
So so that I can live with you forever.
Work in my life.
Work in my life.
Touch my heart.
Touch my heart.
And help me to walk with you.
Help me to walk with you.
Each and every day.
Each and every day.
In Jesus' name I pray.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Woo! I don't know about you, but I'm a little bit fired up right now.
Come on, Bubba.
God's got a plan, folks.
Amen.
Do it. Ask Him for strength. Share with somebody. Make it a goal to share with somebody. Because you know what? If we don't make it part of the plan, we're just going to keep going. He wants to use you so you can take those crowns and lay it at His feet.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you.